Welcome to the next video of the introduction into the viable system model. And in this video, I would like to answer the question, so what? Because after all this theory, you might want to know, so what can I do now with a VSM? How can I apply it? But right at the start, I have to warn you, because all you're going to see is, of course, an interpretation, my interpretation on how to apply the VSM. And there are also other ideas outside in the world, what you can do with it. And there are also people who are quite skeptical about using the mapping approach, so taking the VSM quite literal and applying then or mapping certain structural aspects of an organization into the VSM. I share the concerns, nevertheless, I still like it because at least for me, it helps to get an overview of the landscape of the organization, the territory, and yeah, therefore I think it's quite useful. The scenario that I would like to use in the background of this explanation is the story of four friends who start a new company, and I would like to assume that they do something with AI because it's on the one hand quite hip in these days to do something with artificial intelligence, and at the same time it allows me to use a certain terminology. Therefore, I will look as the system in focus on an agile software development team. And as you have learned in the last videos about the recursions, this recursion is here zero. So the team is the system in focus. There is no other entity above them. There is no other recursion level. They are just a small startup. And how does it start usually? Well, it begins with having an idea to build something. And for instance, maybe one day they sit together in a pub, they have a beer, and suddenly there is this vision, this big idea, that product that they want to build, and how they imagine how it can solve important problems. So they are super thrilled and excited. Hooray, we have our vision. And also in their discussion, they soon and very fast find out what are our values, for instance, our core values or basic beliefs. How do we want to build a company? How do we want to manage it? How we want to make use of participatory elements to create really not only a great product, but also a great company that can last for a long while. Then in this story, I imagine that after they had this beer, there was this kickoff, they do their first workshop. They meet and they want to think now, okay, what should we actually now really build? What is our first step and so on? So they say we need a strategy. And in the best case, we need a product strategy. So maybe they make use of something like the Wortley map. And they have then an overview of their value chain, and they know, at least for the beginning, what are the parts that we're going to build by ourselves, or where do we maybe buy products or even just use commodities, because clearly they don't want to maintain their own servers. Of course, they make use of cloud infrastructure because it's much cheaper, much easier, it scales, and so on. And after they have described, for instance, their product strategy, then they continue, so maybe we need something like a little roadmap and make clear what are the basic steps in order to achieve our vision. And the vision is here symbolized as a little star, a north star. So after the strategy, they have a roadmap in place and at least a first idea how a potential way leading towards the vision could look like. But then, okay, still we are talking about a quite unclear terrain, and how do we start now? And then these four friends say, okay, now let's have a look here at this first step, and we now want to find out what is our MVP, our first minimal viable product where we can learn, get feedback from a real or potential customers in order to understand, are we really solving problems? Does it fulfill the needs of the people, or is there something that we can do better? And for the definition of the MVP, maybe they still stay here in system 4 in the beginning and say, we should then do maybe a design sprint, so a very focused activity where you want to not only learn what are the needs of the customers, but also build something, prototype something very fast, and get also feedback within the sprint to know, are you on course, does it make sense? And in order to do that, of course, they have to not only work here internally in their system 4, but let's imagine they have to go also, of course, outside into the environment. Maybe they acquire their potential customers, they look into the market, what is in place, which theoretical partnerships make sense, or what do they have to take into account regarding law and regulation, GDPR, for instance. And they maybe also start to think, not necessarily during the design sprint, but this is a typical System 4 activity, which suppliers do we need? Which cloud service do we want to use? How about connectivity? Which software licenses do we need? And so on. And of course, most importantly, what are actually the benchmarks outside there? So what is the competition doing? And then after the design sprint, they have their first ideas, their first insights. So there is the first more or less usable prototype in place, but now it's the question, how do we operationalize it? How do we productionize this fast build piece of code into something that can be really put into a production environment? Therefore, now they have to slice the tasks, and in this scenario, they then go down into system 3. So they start with their tactical planning, and that would mean, because they are doing a little bit of Scrum and a little bit of Kanban and a little bit of Agile, that they say, okay, now we need to do our first sprint planning as an activity. And we fill our first backlog, or let's call it, the backlog, because later on, of course, they want to derive them from there, the real sprint backlog. We are here in a special situation where they do, so to speak, the initial filling of the backlog. But at the very end, of course, they want to slice then the tasks in a way that they fit into the sprint rhythm. So you see already, you have here two interesting aspects of an organization. On the one hand, you need certain events, of course, always to maintain a system in the VSM, to bring it into life, to maintain it. And you create, of course, certain artifacts. And usually the meetings and the artifacts are connected. So you run a meeting to create a certain artifact. And what they do, of course, then in this context, well, they write here all these user stories. If you use this concept, or maybe just tasks, it's also fine. I don't want to be too religious about it. This is already maybe enough to start then their first sprint. They know what they're going to do. So they have to go into their daily mode. And here the System 2 comes into play. And what does the System 2 does or provides? Well, it helps on the on a daily basis to coordinate. And they use the usual stand-up logic for 50 minutes. That should be enough to understand what is happening around us. Are there any surprises, positive or negative surprises? And what can we do in order to achieve to burn down our sprint backlog the task within them. Ah ja, what I forgot. Böse, böse. Forgive me, please, of course. Doing all the planning, what do they also do? Everything regarding estimation, for instance, however they estimate. Be it time, story points. Now, I don't want to go now into the details, the pros and cons of the different ways on how to estimate. But they do something like that because they have to know how much work do we want to put into our sprint backlog and be realistic about our own capacity. Okay, so the stand up for 50 minutes is a very simple event again. And there now you see, of course, you do your stand ups usually in front of your Kanban board. So your board that visualizes your processes and the specific user stories or tasks inside them, the status and so on. So that helps a little bit to reflect on where are we moving, in which direction, are we on course, are we able to do everything within the given sprint length. And again, you see here an event and an artifact that is used to do it. And because this team is so small, just four people, you don't have here a typical role, or you don't need actually a typical role like Scrum Master, or let's call it Agile Master. There are different ways, or Agile Coach, does not matter. They are so small, they do it all together. Of course, I could have now integrated, by the way, also here in the systems, the different roles, because they are so small, like I said, just for people, it's really not necessary to distinct them. They are all are doing more or less the same. Therefore, I would like to note here just all people. And that makes also clear, hopefully, that with the VSM and using the VSM and mapping VSM, it's not so easy always to clearly distinct a role or allocate, map a certain role to a certain system. It really depends in the context, because also here in System 4, when they were doing their product strategy and everything around it, all the four guys were together here in System 4. So it's a more contextual mapping that I prefer, and not a static mapping that always says only this person or only this corporate function works in a certain system. It really depends, to my opinion. Good. Then we have now here everything that is needed, that they do their daily coordination. So let's go now into the here and now, System 1. And let's assume also here you find again certain meetings and certain tools or artifacts or certain processes in order to maintain the System 1. And in this example, I assume, for instance, that they defined here we want to have a really nice DevOps approach. Oops. DevOps approach. That means we build a nice pipeline for continuous integration and continuous delivery so that we are able to push changes super fast to the market, to the environment, into the production systems. Furthermore, for the identity of System 1, so the local identity here of this local management, they say, as a practice, as a standard, we want to use, for instance, clean code and everything that is related to this movement. And furthermore, they use, of course, also certain tools. I don't go now in all the details of potential dev tools. I just want to mention them here more on a generic level. Whatever they use, which programming environment, which language they are ever using, of course, they need also certain tools. And from the role perspective, again, we have all people here. And there you see also a funny effect. In the startup situation, you really cannot say that certain people are only here in certain systems, but actually they are all together in the certain systems, depending on the context. Now, let's assume the first sprint is done, and in their logic, they were now publishing something to their first potential customers, into the market. They delivered the promise and hopefully the value in use. The sprint is over. So I like now to show how System 3 can be used to institutionalize a learning loop. And that is done super simply by a retrospective. So they come together as a team and they look back on the how have we built stuff, what can we improve. And again, since they are so small and therefore friends, they have no problems to be honest, look honestly inside of themselves and also challenge themselves to find something that went not so well and get better. What I totally forgot, and that is actually on the other hand, a really funny example, I have not integrated the review. And that is really an interesting question because they are so small and actually they are just in their, let's say, acquisition phase of finding new customers. They don't have really someone with whom they can do the reviews. They are more or less alone. And therefore, in this context, I think that the review actually is happening here on this level when they look on what have we built, what is the quality or what are the qualities of our product or service, and maybe at least they have certain product metrics in place. They give them an indicator regarding, let's say, certain computation times or stuff like that. So no real feedback from customers, but at least from a technological point of view, they have a review. Later on, of course, in an ideal world, they have real customers that they can involve in their reviews. And then one could say either the customers are invited to come into System 3 for the review, or they have to move out into the environment towards the customers and do the review, so to say, outside of the system. However you do it, well, obviously it's necessary to have a review. And again, I would like to make clear from a role perspective, we have not only here all the people, the four friends, but we have, for instance, here also the customer inside if you do a review with a customer within your system. And that really depends. Again, there you see the ambiguities of the VSM. It depends on your context, on how you map and allocate certain aspects in the VSM. Okay. With these examples, I hopefully have shown how we can use the VSM to structure a system and allocate, for instance, people / roles, artifacts, roles, processes, meetings, events into the VSM. And you get an overview of, are you actually doing anything at all within a system? And if you do something, then of course you can ask yourself, well, is it functional or dysfunctional? For instance, are we doing proper retros? And are we really improving one of the most important aspects of the retrospective? Or are we just doing it for the sake of, well, we are agile and it's written somewhere in a guide that you have to do it, but you never generate any action items out of a retrospective? So this is a simple example. It's not enough, of course, to do something, but it's much more important to use it and be full of discipline and also hunger and lust and full of enjoyment to improve. Yeah, that's it actually as a first example on how you can use the VSM.